morning. It's good to see everybody here today on a day when many of us are gone. Danny and his crew and several of those families involved are down at Bible camp, and I know that they're receiving a good lesson there. Nevertheless, we will continue in our fall series, Written in Stone. Today we are on commandment number 4. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Being the fourth one, we need to remember that we have traveled a little ways in our series thus far. Commandment number 1 was, you shall have no other gods before me. The second of the 10 commandments, you shall not make carved images or bow down to them. Last week, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. And if you'll be turning today to Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11, we will take a look at the commandment that we are looking at today. Exodus 20, verses 8 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male or female servant, or your cattle or your sojourner who stays with you. And verse 11 gives us the reason. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. And so we have in these verses the fourth commandment and the reason that it is given. I would like to make a few observations as we begin this morning about this fourth commandment, to remember the Sabbath day and to keep it holy. First of all, the Sabbath day was holy because it belonged to God. It was a day to focus on Him, to serve Him, and serve His purposes. Secondly, the Sabbath day is not the same as Sunday. There is no such thing in Scripture as a Christian Sabbath. As we read in verse 11 of our text, for in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. The seventh day is Saturday. The first day of the week is Sunday. The Christians in the first century met on the first day of the week, which was Sunday. Yes, they did sometimes go to the synagogues where the Jews were meeting on Saturday, but they did so for the purpose of engaging them in study and sharing the gospel with them. But the Christians, the disciples of Christ, met on Sunday, the first day of the week, and we don't read about a quote-unquote Christian Sabbath in the Bible. Perhaps this goes without saying, but I think we need to mention it anyway, that the seventh day or the Sabbath day was a day just like the other 6 days in the creation week. If you look in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 31, you'll see at the end of the sixth day it says there was evening and morning, the sixth day. All of the 6 days of creation had an evening and a morning. And then there was a seventh day, where God rested from His works or ceased from His labor of creation because He was satisfied with it. And so you see that the days of creation fit nicely into a week. We have weeks because of the week of creation and the seventh day that God rested. There is no reason to think, and it's not suggested anywhere in the Bible, that the days of creation represent some kind of different kind of time than a regular 24-hour day. Evolutionists and atheists have concocted that the days of creation represent eons of time because they need billions of years to get the world created as we have it today without God. Exodus 20 and 11 says God took 6 days to create all that we see. And And that's the God we worship. Implied here also in this commandment, in verse 9, is the fact that we're supposed to be busy working. God expects men and women of His creation to be busily engaged in profitable enterprise, working, and especially bearing fruit for Him. Even in the Garden of Eden, Adam was given a job in paradise. That says something about what we are suited to do, to be busily engaged in profitable work. And then there's this other thing. Number 5, this commandment is different than the other 9 commandments that we find in Scripture. What makes this commandment different than the other 9? Well, as has been stated previously in this series, we are not under, in the Christian age, we are not under the authority of the 10 commandments which were given to Moses at Sinai. We're not under any of those. But we serve under the law of Christ, Galatians 6 and verse 2. And in the law of Christ, the other 9 commandments have been restated as having authority in our lives. But commandment number 4, to remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy, well, it's not restated. It is not an obligation of ours to remember the Sabbath or Saturdays and to keep them holy. That's part of the law of Moses. And the reason we do not observe that has been well addressed in your bulletin article that you picked up this morning. We don't observe the Sabbath day anymore because it was nailed to the cross, Colossians 2:14. It was a shadow of things that were to come, verses 16 and 17. And one of those things that was nailed to the cross is enumerated there and listed, and that's the Sabbath day. And so it is that we make some observations concerning this fourth commandment, but we are not under it today. I would draw your attention to Hebrews chapter 4 for our lesson today. Hebrews chapter 4 is the Holy Spirit's application of the Sabbath rest. Now, there are several studies to be engaged in. If you take something from the Old Testament like Jonah and the great fish and the 3 days he spent there, or you take Noah and the ark and the flood which occurred, it's interesting to go to the New Testament and see what the New Testament writers, inspired by the Holy Spirit, what application they make of those Old Testament events. And I believe that's what we have here in Hebrews chapter 4, the Holy Spirit's application of the Sabbath rest. There remains, Hebrews 4 and verse 9, a Sabbath rest for the people of God. What? I thought you just said we're not under the Ten Commandments. I thought you just said that the Ten Commandments were taken away and nailed to the cross. How can there remain today a Sabbath rest for the people of God? Well, I think you'll see as we look at chapter 3 and 4 that we're talking about a different kind of Sabbath rest. The Sabbath rest of Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11, was a command of God to Israel to be obeyed. The Sabbath rest of Hebrews chapter 4, that's a promise that we as Christians today can enjoy. We're talking about two different kinds of Sabbath rest. Notice, if you will, in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 1, that there is a promise remaining of His eternal, a promise remains of His eternal rest, entering His rest. Verse 6, therefore it remains for some to enter it. Our text today, verse 9. So there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. Verse 11, therefore let us be diligent to enter that rest. What's the point? There is rest. There's no doubt about it. There is a Sabbath rest for the people of God that we can enter. That's the Holy Spirit's application of this fourth commandment. We'll come back to this rest, as the old preacher said, if you drive a stake there, and we'll come back to that and look at this rest a little closer. But there is a warning in Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 4, or 3 and chapter 4, about the failure of Israel to enter the rest that God had promised to them. And it's there for our example, not to follow, but for us not to follow. I would like for us to read Hebrews 3, 7 through 19. Incidentally, the scriptures that you see quoted here, perhaps your Bible has some special paragraph or indentation or all caps that denote these are scriptures from the Old Testament. These are all taken from Psalm 95, which was read partially this morning by Benny. But these are beginning in verse 7. Hebrews 3, beginning in verse 7. Therefore, just as the Holy Spirit says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as when they provoked me in the day of trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tried me by testing me and saw my works for 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with this generation and said, they always go astray in their heart and they did not know my ways. As I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Take care, brethren, that there not be in any one of you an evil, unbelieving heart that falls away from the living God. But encourage one another day after day, as long as it is still called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of God, if we hold fast the beginning of our assurance firm unto the end, while it is said, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as when they provoked me. For who provoked him when they had heard? Indeed, did not all those who came out of Egypt led by Moses? And with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who were disobedient? And so we see that they were not able to enter because of unbelief. Israel's pursuit of the rest that God had promised was, for most of them that came out of Egypt, a failure. When we consider the rest, plural, rest of Israel, we know that they had a Sabbath rest that we just read about in Exodus 20. Every seventh day they got a day off, a rest, to focus on God and his purposes and his service. Do you think that after generations and generations and perhaps hundreds of years of slave labor being oppressed by the pharaohs of Egypt, that they might have looked forward to this every seventh day off? I think that probably looked pretty good to them. But that wasn't the only rest that Israel was given. They were promised a land of rest, and we read about that in Deuteronomy 12, verses 8 through 10. And this morning, I feel inadequate to share what's going on in these. I'll just make a confession. I feel inadequate to share all the truths. And you wouldn't want me to if you want to go home before our meeting tonight. And so there's going to be some things in here that you wished we would have talked about or that should have been brought up. We just don't have time to do it. We don't have time to read Deuteronomy chapter 12, verses 8 through 10. But in that verse, they are promised a land of rest. So they had the seventh day of rest. They had the land of rest, the land of Canaan. But that's not all. If we read now in Hebrews chapter 4, beginning at the end of verse 6, where it says they failed to enter because of disobedience. He again fixes a certain day to today, saying through David, after so long a time, just as he had been, has been said before, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them a rest, he would not have spoken another day after that. Hebrews 4:9. So there remains a rest for the people of God. For the one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works, as God did from his. Therefore, let us be diligent to enter that rest. There was a third rest that Israel failed to take advantage of, and that was God's rest. Notice that this Sabbath rest is based upon the fact that God rested on the seventh day from all his works, verse 4. And again in verse 5, they shall not enter my rest. Notice what it says through the prophet David in Psalm 95. Today, if you would hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Verse 8, for if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day after that. Let's pause just a second. In David's day, in Psalm 95, which he gave, he quotes what God said back when Israel was being disobedient. I swore, they shall not enter my rest. But in David's day, this was also given to the people of Israel, who long ago had been given the land of rest, the land of Canaan. They were living in it. But still yet, there is the warning, they shall not enter my rest. And so this land of rest, or this promised rest that Israel failed to enter, was not just the land of Canaan. Verse 8 says, if Joshua had given them rest, he, that is David, would not have spoken of another day after that. And so there remains a Sabbath rest. On day 7 of creation, God ceased from his creative work. He was satisfied with it. And he entered his rest. That rest has been open to the people of God since the seventh day of creation week. And most people have failed to take advantage of the rest that God has entered. That rest is the rest of verse 9. It's open to us. It was open to Israel. It was open to the Israel of the wilderness wanderings. It was open to the Israelites of David's day. And it's open to spiritual Israel today, us in the Lord's church. And Israel utterly failed to enter the rest of God. Real quickly, why did they fail to enter God's rest here in chapter 3? Verse 7, they hardened their hearts and they provoked him. Verse 12, after being believers, they became unbelievers, and we are warned not to follow their example. Their hearts were hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Verse 13, verses 18 and 19, they were disobedient, and they were not able to enter because of unbelief. Even after the 10 plagues on Egypt, even after crossing the Red Sea on dry land, even after the manna and the quail came from above, and they were led by a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, they developed unbelieving hearts because they wouldn't obey God. They didn't trust him, and they fell in the wilderness. And so it is. It can happen to us as well. And so let's make sure that we enter the rest that God has made available for us. There are some things enumerated here in these two chapters that enable us to enter his rest. First of all, let's not, after we have become Christians, in verse 12 of chapter 3, let's do not become unbelieving in our hearts and fall away from the living God. Let's encourage one another, verse 13, while it is still today, while we still have the opportunity of salvation. Let's hold fast, verse 14, until the end. And while it is still called today, that in other words, while we still have opportunity, let's be hearing the Word of God united with faith. Chapter 4 and verse 2. And verse 11 of chapter 4 tells us to be diligent to enter that rest. It is worth our every effort to enter the eternal rest which God has made available to us. And if we could talk for just a minute. The world and all that it has cannot give us what God has to offer us in His eternal rest. There are no good trades that the world can make with us in exchange for God's rest. You can chase your education. You can chase your job and your career. You can drive the newest car and have the newest type of phone that has been issued. You can vacation in the most exotic places that this world has to offer. You can pad your 401k and your retirement account to the point that you'll never spend all that money. And yet, if you in your life fail to enter the rest that God has promised, having attained all of those things, including power and wealth, your life is a failure. We must be diligent to enter the rest, because no one but God can offer it. Well, let's talk a minute about the rest. First of all, our promised rest is a Sabbath rest. It's a Sabbath rest because it comes at the end. When did God rest? He rested at the end, when all the work was finished. When are we supposed to rest? We're supposed to rest at the end, when all the work of life is done. It seems to many people in the church to be a little known fact that to be a disciple of Christ involves work. It involves bearing fruit. For we are His workmanship, aren't we? Created in Christ Jesus, which God, for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Why are we in Christ? Why did He create us as Christians? For good works. We are to be bearing fruit in every good work. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 10. And brethren, if we're not busily engaged in the kingdom, bearing fruit for God, working in this life, we should not expect God to offer us a rest in the next life. It's a Sabbath rest because it comes after the work is finished. And this rest is exclusive, or it has restricted entrance. Not everybody is welcome into this eternal rest that God offers. After all, what does it say in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 9? So there remaineth a Sabbath rest for everybody that's ever been born. Is that what it says? There remains a Sabbath rest for who? The people of God. And that's what is promised. Despite what you have seen at almost every funeral you have ever attended, every eulogy that you've ever read, not everybody is going to enter God's eternal rest because it is restricted for the people of God. I want you to turn with me to Revelation chapter 14 and verse 13. And there John says, and I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on, yes, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their deeds follow with them. Who is it that will enjoy a rest? Who is it that are blessed in death? Well, I hope you've opened your Bible to Revelation 14 and verse 13, but the answer is right there. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Not everybody is blessed in death, but those who are in the Lord are blessed in their death. They are the people of God. And if you would turn back to Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 and verse 27. There remaineth the Sabbath rest for the people of God. Who are they? Well, it's described in Galatians chapter 3, starting in verse 26. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. That sounds like God's people, doesn't it? God's family. For you are all sons of God. The original says, through the faith. Where are you sons of God? Well, you're sons of God in Christ Jesus. Those are the people of God. Well, how did that happen? Galatians 3:27 gives the reason. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. Who are sons of God? They are sons of God in Christ because they were baptized into Christ. The people in the New Testament who were baptized into Christ first believed. Mark 16:16. They repented of their sins, Acts 2 and 38. They confessed their belief, Acts 8 and verse 37. And when they were baptized into Christ, it was in order to be saved, 1 Peter 3:21. It was to have their sins washed away, Acts 22:16, and to have their sins forgiven, Acts 2 and verse 38. Those are the people that were baptized into Christ. How did they get into Christ? Scriptural baptism. Who are the people of God? They are the sons of God described in Galatians chapter 3. They are the people that are blessed in death in the Lord. Revelation 14 and verse 13. And notice that they may rest from their labors and their deeds follow with them. What of these people who are blessed in the Lord and died? What have they been doing? They've been working. They have deeds that follow them, and they rest from their labors. Not everybody is welcome there. Nothing unclean, no one who practices abomination and lying shall ever come into it, but those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Have you ever been to a restaurant, really hungry, and you went up to the front door where they were taking names, and they said, well, we don't see your name on here. I'm sorry, but this is by reservation only. And you can't come in to eat tonight. That's somewhat like it is at the end of life. Only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life will be welcome to come in. This rest is a rest from the struggles of life. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4 tells us that the former things have passed away. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no longer any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away. I don't remember experiencing in my 63 years, most of them spent here, all of my adult life spent here at Hillcrest. I don't remember a harder 2 years, save the split in the late 80s, than the last 2 years that we've had here. Well, I'm tired COVID-19, I'm tired of the sickness. I'm tired of losing people to sickness and death, like Eldon and others. I'm tired of seeing people in this life grow old and crippled and decrepit. I'm tired of separations, not only separations from the miles that split our loved ones from us, I'm tired of the separations that come because of brethren who can't get along. And I'm tired of the tears that come from all of those problems. But the promised rest is a rest from the struggles of life, because the former things are no more. It is also a rest with God. And I heard a voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell with them, among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them." Revelation 21 and 3. The eternal rest which God offers is an invitation to be with him for eternity. He will tabernacle among us. One of my favorite scriptures has become even more a favorite scripture in recent months, in Philippians chapter 1, where Paul says, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." He goes on to say in verse 23 that he's hard-pressed between the two, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, because he says, hey, that's very much better. But to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. The rest that God offers is a rest with him, with God, with Christ. Paul said, if I'm going to live on in the flesh, verse 22, what does that mean? He says it means fruitful labor. The Bible's consistent, isn't it? If we're here in the flesh, we need to be working. But to leave and be with Christ, to be with God, that is very much better. And I don't know about you, but that has been a great source of comfort to me in the past 18 months or so in this congregation. But finally, the rest of God that he offers is a rest at home. The rest that God offers is an invitation to come back home where he is. If we go to our final scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it's Paul again longing to be gone. And he describes our dwelling here as an earthly tent, verse 1, which is torn down, and we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. And he says, we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven. He goes on in verse 8, and he says that we prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be at home with the Lord. Our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's our home. That's where our citizenship is. That's where our spiritual family is. Home is, well, there's no place like it, they say. And home is where the heart is. There have been many, many soldiers deployed overseas who have left by train or plane or ship and gone to serve their country. Some of them have been found in dire straits and made promises to God, one of which I know was still being kept by a preacher of the gospel named Sean DeRee. I'll never forget, as a young boy, going to the train station in Neosho, Missouri. Yes, there was a train station here. And my Uncle Bill, Dad's brother, left home to serve in Vietnam. Many of the soldiers who have found themselves in dire straits, deployed in dangerous places, have kept with them in their wallet or their pocket a token of affection. Home is where the heart is. And they had in their possession a picture of mom and dad, a picture of their girlfriend, a picture of their wife or their children. And they were homesick to go back home to be with family. That's where they came from. You know what happens when we die? We go back where we came from. Ecclesiastes 12 and verse 7 says, the spirit returns to God who gave it. We go back home to God. I hope this morning that your heart is set on the hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised long ages ago. Titus chapter 1 and verse 2. Our text in Hebrews chapter 4 says in verse 1, therefore let us fear, while a promise remains of entering his rest, that any of you would seem to have come short of it. We need to be paying attention. It's too great a rest to miss, and each of us need to be there, back home with God. If your life were to end this afternoon by death, or if the Lord would return today with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and obey not the gospel, would you be prepared to enter God's rest as a part of God's people? If not, we would love to help you make preparation for that. We would love for you to be able to be ready for the eternal rest of God. And we can do that. Why don't you come as we stand and sing this song?